Okay, so you good? Sound
yes,
good?
Yes, good, sir.
All right, okay, good.
Yes, sir.
Tell me about your beliefs. What do you believe about Jesus?
So I believe that Jesus is the Messiah, mm-hmm. and he is the Son of God, mm-hmm. and he's my king and my brother.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what I believe.
Okay, what do you believe about his pre-human existence?
Oh, yeah, I don't believe he pre-existed as literally the Son of God.
Why?
Or an angel. I believe he existed in the plan and mind of God.
Why? Why do you believe that?
Because the Bible says so.
Where?
In Acts 2. Let's turn to Acts 1 second.
Acts 2, 22. Is that what you're going to quote?
Yes, you're right.
Yeah, but Acts is written by Luke, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so why would you start in Acts 2 when Luke begins in Luke chapter 1? Because he wrote Luke in Acts.
Because... Are you done, brother? I'm so sorry.
No, what I'm saying is that's not how you interpret the Bible, by skipping what the author mm-hmm. writes. He begins mm-hmm. his discussion in Luke chapter 1 because in Acts 1 he's writing to the same person, Theophilus, right?
Mm-hmm.
So why are you beginning in Acts 2:22 when it's Peter preaching to the Jews, the same Jews that had Jesus crucified, and he emphasized that Jesus is a man because he can't mm-hmm. begin. He can't begin by telling the Jews that Jesus is the God of the Old Testament in the flesh. So why are you starting in Acts chapter 2?
I mean, that's when he was filled with the Holy Spirit. Right. Mm-hmm. And he started preaching. So that's the message that he wants to share to the whole world. There were so many thousands of people there. Mm-hmm. Right. He could have used any words. He could yes. have said the Son of God died for you. But he chose this particular words.
Did the Son of God die for them?
Yes, he did. Okay, where he could did have Peter also say? Said like how Trinitarians say. That
okay.
God
can you
died
show me in Acts 2? Sister, can you show me in Acts 2 where he says Jesus, Son of God, who died for you?
That's what I'm telling you, brother. It doesn't say that.
But is it true, though? Right. Is he the Son of God?
It's true. It
Did
is
he
true.
Die for
I
us?
I didn't deny that. But he is using a specific word. Mm-hmm. And not like Trinitarians. Trinitarians have the way of saying that God died for us.
No, I'll so get to the Trinitarians. Please don't tell us what Trinity. I'm a Trinitarian. Don't tell me how we preach. What I'm telling you is okay, I'm going by God. Your logic. I'm going by your logic. Sure. But he didn't say Jesus is the Son of God. And he didn't say he died for them. So why do you believe he's the Son of God who died for you? Acts 2 doesn't say that.
Yes, but it doesn't say that God died for you, right?
You're not answering the question. Why do you believe Jesus, Son of God, who died for you? In Acts 2, he didn't say any of that. You're not answering the question.
Okay, I believe the Son of God died because of what the Bible says in the other parts, like Matthew, Mark.
Other parts. Oh, other parts. So thank you. You now proved my point. So let's go to the other parts and not stick to the part that you think makes your case, right? Go to Luke chapter 3 and read verses 1 to 6.
It's not, so brother,
yes.
Bible was started from Matthew, right? Matthew is the base. You can
no,
start
not,
from
okay,
Matthew.
Now, let's hold on. Before you go on, make up your mind, sister. Let's not play these games. Let's respect the word of God. You went to Acts. Luke wrote Acts and he wrote Luke. So do you want to go to Luke? Because you went to Acts. I'm following you. Or do you want to ignore Luke?
Anything is fine. Yeah, if okay. you want to go to Luke, I can go to Luke. If you want to go okay. to Matthew, I can go to Matthew.
Okay. So basically, now, what do you want to do? You want to Acts. Now, do you want to stick with Luke or do you want to go to Matthew? I'm going to let you decide. Okay. But stick okay. with, here, one thing. Sister, confusion. Hold on. Sister, for us to get the most of the dialogue, let's not talk over each other. Listen to me carefully. Do you want now, because I'm going to go with your book, whatever book you use, we're going to stick with it. Do you want to go to Matthew?
Sure.
Do you want Matthew?
Everything is fine. Started my message. This is my message that I wanted to get to, that Jesus is a man.
Well, no, I'm going to show you he's more than a man. Any book you quote, I'm going to show you he's more than a man. But which book do you want to go to now? Hold on. Do me a favor, Angie. Yeah. Good.
Let's go to Luke, like you said. No problem.
Okay. Go to Luke chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. Luke chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. Read that for me slowly.
15, Luke 3, verse 1, right?
If I'm start at 1 and read all the way to 6 slowly.
Okay. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate, being governor of Judea, and Hebrew, being tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip, tetrarch of the region of Curia, and Pontius and Licentius, tetrarch of Abilene, in the high priest of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region about the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, the voice of man crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Done, brother.
Okay. What prophecy does John the Baptist fulfill?
Isaiah, the voice of one crying in the wilderness.
Okay, go to Isaiah chapter 40 and read verses 3 to 5.
So it says, a voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Yeah, done.
Okay, okay, you're at 3. Now, the voice is preparing for who's coming?
It's preparing the way.
For who?
Of the Lord.
And make a highway for who?
For Yahweh.
Yeah, our God, Lord. Right?
Yeah.
Okay, and then read verse 5, because that was also quoted.
Okay. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken.
And then in that same chapter, just to make sure we're not missing the point so we don't twist it, because we'll be sinning against God if we twist his word, read verses 9 to 11.
Okay, same chapter, right?
Yes, same chapter.
Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up, fear not, says the cities of Judah. Behold your God. Behold, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him.
Mm-hmm.
Behold, his sword is with him, and his recompense before him.
Okay, now.
Heaven also?
Yes, well, you got to read 11. Go ahead.
Okay. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom and gently lead those who are with young.
Okay. Clearly, you read it, and if you're going to read it honestly, it says, your God is coming, and his arm will rule for him, and his recompense comes with him. It's not a creature that's coming. It's Israel's God, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, Jehovah. He is coming. So the voice that cries out is preparing for the coming of Jehovah God. Now, before we see who that is, I need you to go to Luke 7:27.
Okay, 1 second, brother. I need little clarity on 40 verse 10.
Say it again.
Is that the Lord God... Mm-hmm. comes with might,
mm-hmm.
and his arm rules for him.
That's right. Keep reading.
And his recompense before him.
Mm-hmm.
So who do you think the arm rules for him? What do you think that means?
It's going to backfire against you, because in Isaiah, the arm of God is not a creature. It's God coming in his power. Go to Isaiah 59:16. Because I don't think you want to go there. It's not going to help your case. Go to Isaiah 59:16.
Okay, Isaiah?
Yeah, go to Isaiah 59, read 15 to 16. Because the arm of the Lord is not a creature, not a man. It's God coming in his own power. So it's not going to help your case. But go to Isaiah 59, read 15 and 16.
15 and 16. Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Truth is lacking, and he who departs from evil makes himself a prey. The Lord saw it, and it displeased him that were no justice. He saw that there was no man, and wondered that there was no one to intervene.
Mm-hmm.
Then his own arm brought him victory, and his righteousness upheld him.
Okay, read 16 one more time so that everyone gets it. Slowly, 16 one more time.
Okay, he saw that there was no man,
mm-hmm.
and wondered that there was no one to intervene.
Mm-hmm.
Then his own arm brought him victory, and his righteousness upheld him.
Yeah, so we don't twist the Bible and play ping pong with it. It says, because there was no man worthy enough, mm-hmm. and no one, so God did it in his own arm. So the arm of God does not refer to a creature. It refers to God coming in his own power. Now, to make that point clearer, go to Isaiah 63, verse 5.
Isaiah 63,
verse 5.
Verse 5. I looked, but there was no one to help. Mm-hmm. I was upheld, but there was no one to uphold. So my own arm brought me victory, and my wrath upheld me.
Yes, now I know because you fear God and you respect the Bible, you're not going to play games with it. This is why I'm having conversation with you. So we just read it. God's arm is not a man or a creature. It's God coming in his own power, in his own strength, which is why in Isaiah 40 it says, behold your God, make a highway for our God, not a creature. So we're not going to play games and to change the meaning of the words. So now with that said, mm-hmm. we've established who the arm is. The arm is God's own power, not a creature. Now, before I show you who that is, can you go to Luke 7:27?
One second, brother. I need a little more clarity there. You said a who.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. You already established that it's not a who. It's God's power.
No.
Right?
I'm going to establish that it's a who. It's God in the flesh. You be patient. I'll show you. Because I can give you more verses. But for clarity, we're not going to play games. Let's go to Luke 7:27 to get more clarity. Luke 7:27.
Could you repeat the sentence? 20, is it?
Luke 7:27, Jesus is talking about John the Baptist.
Okay, one second. So it says, this is he of whom it is written, behold, I send my messenger before thy face, who shall prepare the way before thee.
Okay, so Jesus says, John is the messenger mentioned in Malachi 3, verse 1. The messenger sent to prepare for your face. Now, can you go to Malachi chapter 3, verse 1?
Malachi chapter 3, verse 1, brother.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Behold, I send my messenger to prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts.
Okay, now do you know what the words the Lord is in Hebrew? The Lord?
Yeah, there are two types of Hebrew words that you can use.
Yeah. No, in this
Adonai
verse,
or Yahweh and Adoni. Or a normal Lord, a human Lord.
Neither Adonai nor Adonai appears in this Hebrew. That's why I ask you, do you know the words in this verse?
So here it says in the first, I send my messenger to prepare the way before me, and the Lord. Here in my Bible, it's lowercase.
Mm.
So it might be Adonai. I am not.
No, it's not Adonai.
Here,
no, I'm telling you.
I might not be.
Yeah, I'm telling you. It's not Adonai. I know. The very pathetic argument of Anthony Buzzard and Adonai, which I will butcher in a minute. But before we go there, it's not Adonai, it's not Adonai, it's not Adonenu, it's not Adonim. The words are Ha-Adon. Ha-Adon. Can I ask you, are the words Ha Adon ever used for anyone besides Jehovah? Do you know or no?
I don't know, Father.
Well, I'm going to help you, sister. That's why I'm here, to be used of God to help you. The words Ha Adon are only used for the true God, never used for a man. Ha Adon. And if you want proof it's not a man, it says, suddenly the Lord whom you seek is coming to his temple. Now, sister in humanity, can you show me a verse in the Bible where the temple was built for a man and not for the true God?
No, temple was not built for any man.
Okay, not for any man, right?
Nope.
So the Lord that's coming to his temple, read the verse carefully. It says, the Lord whom you seek is coming to his temple. That's Jehovah God. He's coming because the temple belongs to Jehovah. So now you just read two verses, because I'm going to repeat this, because when I ask you a question, you read it. We're going to have to be honest to the Bible. You just read Malachi 3:1. A messenger is going to be sent, and when he shows up, right away, suddenly after him, the Lord will be coming to his temple. The temple is built for Jehovah, not a man. And then in Isaiah 40, it says, a voice will be crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way for Jehovah, Yod, He, Vav, He, and make a highway for our God. The Lord Jehovah's coming in his own arm, not a creature, but God Almighty. Right so far?
Yes.
Okay, so Jesus just said John the Baptist is the messenger of Malachi 3, verse 1. And then you read in Luke 3 that John the Baptist is the voice of Isaiah chapter 40. So are we clear it's John the Baptist?
Yes, the messenger is John the Baptist.
And he's the voice in the wilderness, right?
Yes.
Okay, go to Acts 19, verse 4.
Okay. So it says that, and Paul said, John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him. This is Jesus.
Okay. So John,
on hearing this, they were baptized. Okay.
Okay. So John the Baptist was preparing for Jesus, right? Okay, but yes. The verses you read, sister, and again, I'm recording this. The verses you read said John the Baptist is the voice, the messenger sent to prepare for Jehovah, Israel's God, the Lord who's coming to his temple. So now convince me Jesus is just a man when John the Baptist is preparing for Jesus, but the prophecies say the person that's coming, that John the Baptist is preparing for, is the Lord of the temple, who's coming to his temple, who's Jehovah our God. Now convince me Jesus is not God in the flesh, he's just a man. Convince me.
Okay. So when you say God in the flesh, can I get a little clarity on that, please?
Yes, it's John 1, verse 14. The word became flesh. What does that mean?
It doesn't say God in flesh. It says the word.
Yes, it does, actually.
Became flesh.
No, it does, because it says the word was God, and if the word was God, he became flesh. You can't separate that. John 1, 1 and 14. You can't separate the two.
So, okay, brother, when you read it in context, right, it says the word became flesh. Let's not add words.
No, sister, we're not going to ignore verse 14 from John 1, 1. John 1, 14 didn't start in verse 14. It started 1. So let's not subtract from the word. John 1, 1 says the word was God and the word became flesh. So no, you don't start 14 and ignore verse 1. Who is the word? The word was God who became flesh. Now explain to me, what does it mean that the word was God? See, now we went there.
Okay, I would say that God was manifested in flesh. Right?
That's like not what the verse says, though.
Apostles.
That's not what the verse
God
says.
God was manifested in flesh. That's what it says in the Bible.
No, that's not what it says in John 1, nor does the prophecies that we read. Neither Malachi 3, nor Isaiah 40, nor John 1 says simply appeared in flesh. That's not what it says. God himself is coming, and then that word who is God became flesh, not simply appeared in flesh.
God was manifested in flesh, right?
No, not John 1. It said became flesh. I corrected that.
So I need again a clarity, because what do you mean by God manifested in flesh when the apostles say about it?
I didn't say manifest, sister. I used the word of John 1:14. In your Bible, it says the word was made flesh or became flesh, agenita. Can you give me clarity? What does it mean the word became flesh, not simply appeared? Because manifest means appear. Now, I need clarity from your part. Explain to me what it means for the word to become flesh.
So it means that the word of God, the plan, the action of God was finally put into action.
That's not what John 1 says.
I mean, you asked me to explain it. Right?
Yeah. Do you understand? Okay. Explain to me what it means that the word was, and I'm going to use the phrase because it appears in John. Pros ton theon. What does pros ton theon mean?
I don't agree, brother.
Okay, well, sister, you're going to argue against the Trinity and not know these words? Okay, can you go to John 1, verse 1 and 2? Because I'm going to teach you a little Greek.
Right, I'm not an expert, that is true, but doesn't mean that I've not done a little bit of research that any layman can read the Bible and be moved by the Holy Spirit also. Yeah.
Well, that's the question. Are you moved by the Holy Spirit?
Finish.
Good.
Yeah.
Good.
So yeah, and John 1:1 doesn't have to be translated like that. If you check the NET, New English Bible, it also says what God was, the Word was.
Wait. Right? So what does that mean? What God was, the Word was. So a plan is what God is.
Are you making sense? It's fully expressive. Your words are expression of yourself. Your logic.
That's not what the NEB Bible says. Not NET. It's NEB. I know what you're appealing to. The translators in the NEB are telling you that the word is whatever God is, because it's referring to the nature of the word. I know the translation. I know the argument. I've studied it. But is that what John said? What the word, what God was, the word was? Or did he say the word was God? Why are you giving me a paraphrase? Now, can you go to John 1 and read verses 1 and 2 for me?
Sorry, which was, brother?
Go to John 1, verses 1 and 2 for me. John 1, verse 1 and verse 2.
John 1,
verses 1 and 2, yeah.
He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him.
No, you went to verse 3. Start at verse 1 and then read verse 1 and 2.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning.
Go ahead.
Sorry. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made.
No, you don't need to go to verse 3. What I'm going to do is I'm going to send you in your link in the comment section. I'm going to send you the link. You don't need to read the Greek. It's in English too. Okay, here's what I want you to do. So you don't need to. You don't even need to know Greek. Click there. I just sent it to you. Click on it. What do you do? Let me know. When you click on it, let me know. Did you see it? I sent it in your comment section.
Nope, I didn't get it.
Okay, well, yeah, if you look at your comments, you should have the ability to comments, because I don't want to just, I want you to see it so you can see I'm not lying to you what it says.
Yeah, I'm not able to see it.
All right. I don't know, because you usually in your face, in your Skype, you can type. You know where you were typing to me? You were typing comments. We're talking comments, so you should have a box that you click on. See, but anyway, if you don't see it now, you can click on it later. The words are pros, P-R-O-S, pros, ton, theon, T-O-N, T-H-E-O-N. That's, those are the words with God, with God. Now, go to John 16, because you're going to see why I'm bringing this up. Go to John 16 and slowly read for me verses 25 to 31, slowly. John 16. 25.
I mean, I have spoken to you in figures. The hour is coming when I shall no longer speak to you in figures, but tell you plainly of the Father. In that day you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I shall pray the Father for you. Mm-hmm. But the Father himself loves you because you have loved me and have believe that I came from the Father.
Go all the way to 31. Don't stop. Keep reading.
Okay. I came from the Father and I've come into the world again. I am leaving the world and going to the Father. Mm-hmm. His disciples said, now you are speaking plainly, not in any figure. Now we know that you know all things and we need none to question you. By this we believe that you came from God. Jesus answered him, do you now believe the hour is coming?
You can stop there at 31. You need to do it. Okay, I want you to pay attention carefully to what you read. Jesus said, I'm not speaking figuratively, I'm speaking plainly. That's why I want you to read verse 29 one more time.
29?
Yes, one more time. So you know it's not figurative, it's plainly, speaking plainly. What is he, what the disciples say in 29?
Now you are speaking plainly, not in any figure. Okay. Now we know that you know all things and need none to question you. By this we believe that you came from God.
Okay, now I want you to read 28 one more time.
28, right?
Yes.
Okay. So I came from God and have come into the world again. I'm not leaving the world and going to, I am leaving the world and going to the Father.
Now, do you see the words to the Father? Mm-hmm. The words is pros tan patera. The word pros, to pros tan patera. It is similar to John 1:1, pros Tan Theon. I am going pros tan patera to the Father. Now, let me ask you a question. Did Jesus leave the world as an idea, or did he leave the world as a person and went to be with the Father as a person?
He went to Father as a person.
Okay, but now here's what we're not going to do. We're not going to play games with the text because he's speaking plainly. So when it says he came into the world and now he's leaving the world. So when he came into the world, he came in as an idea?
When he came into the world, right, he was born as a child.
That's not what the text says. Reread it.
Okay.
Read 27, 28.
And have come into the world again. I'm leaving the world and going to the Father.
So when he left the world to the Father, he left as a person. But when he came from the Father into the world, you're saying he didn't come as a person from the Father into the world. Why? Why?
Coming from the Father, it doesn't mean a location. John was from God.
That's not what I said, sister. Sister, I didn't say, you're not listening. I know your argument. I know what you're going to say. John chapter 1, verse 6. You're not hearing me. I'm going to repeat it a third time. If in that verse, the leaving the world and going to the Father is something he actually did as a person, you can't separate it from the first half of the argument because they both go together and he's speaking plainly. I came forth from the Father into the world. So yes, it is a location. Wherever he was not in the world, and he came into the world, and he's going to leave the world and go to the Father from where he came. Both statements are there. You can't chop it up and make one thing say one thing and the other thing say something else. He's speaking plainly. That's why the disciples then go say, now we know you came from the Father. Can you show me in John 1:6 where it says, John came from the Father into the world, came from the Father into the world.
You can read John 20:21.
That's not going to help you, sister.
It's the same way how Jesus was sent into the world. Jesus is sending his disciples.
Not the same way. No.
World.
Because if you go back to John 16, we're not going to leave John 16. I know it's hard for you, but you're going to deal with it. Read it again. I'm not speaking figuratively. I'm speaking plainly. And plainly, I'm telling you, I came forth from the Father into the world. I'm leaving the world and going to the Father. You just admit, leaving the world, he's leaving as a person and going to the Father as a person. But the first half is there. I came forth from the Father into the world. You can't have your cake, eat it too. If leaving the world and going to the Father, he did as an actual person, then coming from the Father into the world, he must have been a person as well. You can't get around that.
Then how do you, how do you explain John 20:21, where clearly, plainly, Jesus also says the same thing?
No, he doesn't, but go ahead, read. Read it. It's not the same. I know what you're referring to. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. Where does he say, as the Father sent me from himself into the world, I'm sending you from myself into the world?
One second.
John 20:21. I know the verse.
No, it's not John 20:21.
Yeah. John 17:18. Yeah, I know where you're going to go with, but so make up your mind so I can know which passage you want to deal with.
Jesus is clearly making us understand what he means, right? So it's all the same here. It says the same thing here. It says that as thou didst send me into the world, so I have sent them into the world.
It's not the same
thing. So sending them.
It's because
then you need to explain to me how Jesus is sending the disciples into the world.
Very easy. You can send someone into the world who's already in the world, or you can send someone into the world who's from heaven. Like when God says an angel into the world, we know the angel came from heaven. But in the case of the disciples, they're already in the world and he sends them into the world. But you're not listening to me because you ignored again John 16:27-28. So we're going to go back. Can now you show me where Jesus says about the disciples, they came forth from the Father into the world. They're going to leave the world and go to the Father. You're not going to find that language. So maybe my English is not too clear. I'm going to ask it a fourth time. One more time, and I'm going to come back to John 17. Okay, let's try it again. Do you believe when Jesus said, I'm leaving the world and going to the Father? He left as a person or as an idea?
He went as a person.
So then the first part, let's now take the whole sentence. I came forth from the Father into the world. I'm leaving the world and going to the Father. If the second part means he went to the Father from the world as a person, why then do you deny that he came from the Father into the world as a person?
Because Matthew says that in the genealogy. Luke says that, right?
Okay, we can go to Matthew. Well, before you do that, now we jumped, right? So which book do you want to go to? You want to go to Matthew? Because Matthew's not going to help you.
I think we were talking about something else, and it's going to something else.
Okay, so which book of Matthew you want to go? Do you want to go back to John 17, or you want to go to Matthew?
No, the first question the initial question was to prove that not a man, right? A man was not coming, but God himself. I think that was the first question.
That's what Isaiah said and Malachi said. Yep.
Yep. So that's the first question. So I love to finish that question also, but yeah, I don't know where you're heading.
No, because I'm trying to follow you, because we went here, you told me what it means for Jesus to be in the flesh, and I went to John 1:14. I'm answering your question. So let's go back to Isaiah chapter 40 and Malachi 3:1. Who is coming according to Isaiah 40 and Malachi chapter 3:1?
So ultimately, it's Yahweh coming.
Okay.
Right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes. But when we read the New Testament, right? So first, Jesus is going to come in the glory of his Father, right?
Yeah.
So, and God will judge the world through a man. It clearly says.
Now you went to Acts 17, 30, 31. You changed it again. Don't go to Acts 17, 30, 31. According to Isaiah chapter 40 and Malachi 3:1, who is coming?
The coming one, I don't know what time you're meaning, but ultimately Yahweh is going
to
come.
No, it doesn't say ultimately. According to Matthew chapter 3 and Luke chapter 3, John the Baptist fulfills Isaiah chapter 40 and Malachi 3:1. He shows up, and both prophecies say when he shows up, God is coming to his temple. He's going to show up. In fact, Malachi 3:1 says, and then suddenly, not delayed in the distant future, suddenly the Lord whom you seek will come to his temple. That means right when John shows up, right away, immediately, the Lord is going to come to his temple. Who's the Lord that came to his temple? Yeah, that's what Malachi 3:1 said. You read it. It said, behold, I send my messenger ahead of me to prepare my way, and suddenly the Lord whom you see will come to his temple. So John came.
Can I explain it, brother?
I hope you explain it accurately and not tell me what you think. Go ahead.
So when you read Matthew chapter 3, let's go there.
Yes, go to Matthew chapter 3, verse 3, and then... again, Matthew 11:10, he quotes it again.
1 second, brother. So when I say that, when you say that, it reminds me of when John the Baptist, right?
Yeah.
He baptized Jesus, right? And suddenly the heavens were opened and a voice from heaven was heard. And Jesus is the temple, according to what I understand. And Yahweh's Holy Spirit rested on him.
Now, so this can you show me? Can you show me where in Matthew says Jesus' temple? Because now you're confusing too many gospels together. But I'm going to address you.
Is he not the temple, Jesus?
Where does Matthew say? No, don't ask me a question. Prove your assertion. Where does Matthew say Jesus is the temple? Because you didn't read Malachi 3:1 carefully. But where does Matthew say Jesus is the temple?
Jesus himself says he is the temple of God, where? Let me find the verse for you.
I know where. In John 2, 19, 22. So we're back to John 1 again. So you want to go back to John 1?
In Matthew, it's not there, is it?
No. Jesus says he's greater than the temple in Matthew 12. But
the physical temple, right?
He's greater than the temple. The physical temple, yes. Okay, now, sister, you confuse too many issues because you're not listening to the passage again. Let's go to Matthew 11:10. I want you to pay attention because it's not Jesus is the temple of God. Jesus is God who then created a body to be his temple. And I'll show you the difference in a minute. But you need to pay attention better because when you don't pay attention, you're going to make these mistakes. Go back to Matthew 11:10.
Okay,
pay attention to how Jesus quotes it.
Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, who shall prepare thy way before thee.
Okay, now, before you move on, who's speaking to who? Read it again. Jesus is quoting it about John. But who's talking to who? Behold, I send my messenger ahead of you to prepare for your face, right? Who's speaking to who?
This is Jesus quoting Isaiah.
Yes. No, he's not quoting Isaiah. He's quoting Malachi 3:1.
Yeah, he's talking to the disciples quoting this verse.
Yeah. And when he's quoting it, who is speaking in the verse? Because he says, this is he, John, of whom it is written, see, I send my messenger ahead of you to prepare for your face. Who's the one speaking in that verse?
It's Yahweh, I think.
Okay, and Yahweh's talking to who? Read it again carefully.
Oh,
Malachi and Matthew 11, 10.
He is the Lord.
No, I'm saying Matthew 11, 10.
Mm-hmm.
Read what Jesus says. This is he of whom it is written. And when he quotes, it says, see, mm-hmm. I am sending my messenger ahead of you to prepare for your face. So the one who said, I send my messenger, is talking to someone. Who is he talking to?
It's talking to the Lord again, Yahweh.
The Lord is talking to the Lord. You got to pay attention, understand it before we move on. Say it again.
It's not clear here. It says D. I have to go back to Isaiah and check again.
It's not Isaiah. It's Malachi 3 verse 1. If you read it, it's Malachi 3. But pay attention. It's, see, I am sending my messenger ahead of you. So that means I am speaking to someone. I am sending my messenger ahead of you, and he'll prepare mm-hmm. for your face. It's the Father speaking to the Son. Reread it.
Okay,
but you have a problem now. Because in Malachi 3:1, here you have the Father saying, I send my messenger of you to prepare for your face. That means it's the Son coming to his temple. It's not the Son who is the temple. He's the one coming to his temple.
So he's the temple?
No.
And he's also the temple of God?
He's not the temple here. He is the God coming to his temple, because the Father is saying, I'm going to send my messenger ahead of you to prepare your way, which means the one who's coming is the Son, and it's the Son who's the Lord coming to his temple. That's how Jesus is interpreting it. So it's not Jesus is the temple and God shows up in Jesus's body. Jesus is the God who comes to the temple in Jerusalem. So now you're stuck with the point I made. If Jesus is
the temple, and he claims to be the temple, it's confusing.
Well, you can be confused all you want. I'm just telling you what the verse says. You can laugh.
Because you're not quoting what Jesus said.
I did. Who quoted Malachi 3:1? My mother or Jesus?
I'm asking you, what is Jesus quoting about himself? He said, I am Malachi 3:1.
You just quoted it. I just gave you Jesus. You're saying what Jesus quoted, Malachi 3:1, Matthew 11:10. He quoted it. Mm-hmm. So I am going by what Jesus is saying. But now you're going to confuse me, because I want you to go to Matthew 12 and read verses 6 to 8.
Okay, so it says that, or have you not read that the law on how...
No, go to Matthew 12, read Matthew chapter 12, 6 to 8.
Okay, I will tell you something greater than the temple is here. If you had known what this means, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the guiltless, for the Son of Man is the Lord of the Sabbath.
Okay, now in Matthew 12:6, he goes, something greater than the temple is here. Who is that that's greater than the temple that was there?
It's Jesus.
Okay, so but sister, now you confuse me. I thought Jesus is the temple. So how can he be the temple and greater than the temple? See, you confused me.
He's greater than the physical temple.
Which one?
He's greater than the physical temple.
Oh, but he is the temple. How can he be greater than the temple? You see, this is your logic. This is what you're doing to me.
God is going to be dwell in a man, right?
Okay, but so wait. You're saying Jesus can be the temple and then be greater than the temple?
Yes, he can.
Okay, so now you make my point. Why then did you say, oh, Jesus is the temple and he's coming to the temple? Oh, it's confusing. But you just said the same thing I said. Jesus is the temple and greater than the temple. How come you're not confused now?
No, you said the Lord is coming to his temple.
That's what Malachi 3:1 said. Malachi 3:1 said that. I didn't make it up. It said the Lord is coming to his temple. That's the prophecy. But sister, I want you to pay attention to what you said. Let me repeat it. I want you to hear yourself. Oh, Jesus is the temple and coming to the temple. It's confusing. But hear yourself. You just said Jesus is the temple and he's greater than the temple. And you're not confused by what you just said? Astaghfirullah.
Okay, let me give you a clarity. It said Jesus is the Lord coming to the temple. But yes. Jesus is claiming to be greater than the physical temple.
Which temple?
Hello? Can you hear me, brother?
Yes, which temple is he greater than?
I can't hear you.
Hello? You should hear me. The connection's good.
Second.
Hello? Hello?
Yep, now I can hear you.
Okay. Yeah. So which temple is he greater?
Let me quote what you said before you confuse me.
Yeah, no. Which temple is Jesus greater? He's greater than what temple?
He's greater than the physical temple.
You mean the one in Jerusalem,
God
right?
Jesus.
The one in Jerusalem, right?
Yes.
But in Malachi 3:1, it says the Lord is coming to his temple. What temple is he coming to?
He's coming to Jesus?
No, that's not what Malachi 3:1 says. It says he's coming to his temple. What temple is he coming to?
It doesn't say it is a physical temple.
Yes, it does, because a Jew... No, sister, temple. You're playing games with the text. A Jew who read Malachi 3:1 would know... I'm answering your question. A Jew who read Malachi 3:1 would know that the temple he's coming to is the physical temple. There was no other temple for him to come to. So let's not play with the word of God. That's satanic. Let's deal with the text. A Jew who reads Malachi 3:1 and reads, the Lord is coming to his temple, would know the physical temple in Jerusalem. Let's not play with the games.
Okay, let's say that. Okay, so let's say you are talking about the physical temple.
Yeah.
Just for the sake of argument, right? So let's say that. And Emmanuel means God with us, right?
Sure.
And when Jesus was born, right, yeah, he was the physical embodiment of God dwelling among them.
And why is he the right? physical embodiment of God?
Because he was the image of the invisible God. He okay. is the Word manifested. I mean, the God manifested in flesh.
Okay, but in 1 Corinthians 11:7, it says Adam is the image and glory of God. So was Adam the physical embodiment of God?
He was not the perfect image.
Okay, but hold on, well, sister. The 1 Corinthians 11:7 says, man in general is the image and glory of God. So that means man, starting with Adam, is the physical embodiment of God. So am I the physical embodiment of God?
You're not the perfect.
And doesn't say I have to be perfect, because it said I am the image and glory of God. Don't add words to the text.
Let me go to the text. Give
yes.
me a minute.
Go to 1 Corinthians 11:7.
1 Corinthians 11:7. Yeah, okay. So it says, for a man ought not to cover his head, since he is in the image and the glory of God.
It doesn't say in the image. It didn't say that. It said he is the image. It doesn't say in the image.
For a man ought not to cover his head, since he is the image of God, image and glory of God, but woman is the glory of man.
So man in general, starting with Adam, is the image and glory of God. So am I the physical embodiment of God? So now you can call me your Lord and God and worship me?
No, you're just the image of God, the glory of God.
Oh, that's it? But that's what you just said about Jesus. You said Jesus is the image of God.
Perfect. You sinned, so you're not perfect.
Well, sister, where does it say that perfection is something necessary for me to be the physical embodiment of God? Why are you adding to the text? The text didn't say that.
Jesus is the perfect image of the invisible God.
But it doesn't say perfect image of the invisible God. You add it to the text. Colossians 1:15 says he is the image of the invisible God. Why are you adding words?
Let me just check that.
Colossians 1:15. I know where you're going. 2 Corinthians 4:4. But go to Colossians 1:15. He is the image of the invisible God and the firstborn of all creation. Why you add the word perfect?
Because he is the only one who perfectly obeyed God.
Yeah, right? But that's not what the text says. Sister, you're confusing too many issues. Relax. It didn't say He is the perfect image of God. And because he's the perfect image of God, he's the physical embodiment of God. That's not what it said. It said he's the image of God. And you said, because he's the image of God, he's the physical embodiment of God. When I told you man is the image of God, oh, but he's not perfect. So you're adding words. Why are you adding words to the text?
Let me not use the word perfect. Let's say all have sinned except for Jesus.
And that's fine. Have the angels sinned?
The angels, few angels did.
Okay, I'm talking about Michael and Gabriel.
No, okay. They didn't, but they are not the image of God.
Right? Where does it say angels are not in the image of God?
Where does it say, brother? You can show me where it says.
I'll show you step by step, but take it one at a time. Where does it say angels? I'm saying, where does it say they're not in the image? Because you said they're not. See, you made the assertion.
Okay, so that actually backfires against you.
No, it actually proves my point, because no angel is said to be God.
Okay, let me finish it. So you said angels are the image of God. That's your argument, right?
Go ahead, yes. Go ahead.
Okay, so that backfires against most of the Trinitarians who say and claim in Genesis that he made them in the image of God, both man and woman, right? They were created in the image of God. He said, let us make, right? So you are saying, by your argument, we can consider angels to be in the image of God. So can we conclude that he was talking to the angels?
Not at all.
Okay, why do you say that now?
Because in the next verse it says, God alone created man, and male and female. So that backfired against you, but you're changing the subject.
It says, you said that angels are in the image of God.
Sure, they can be.
Is a Trinitarian, I mean, okay, I don't want to quote Trinitarian.
Yeah, but you're not hearing my argument. You know how I know he's not talking to angels? You're not hearing me again. Let me try it again. Because in Genesis 1:27, it says God alone made man. So he was not talking to the angels, because whoever he's talking to, he's telling the people he's talking to, the person he's talking to, let us make man. But the angels didn't make man, he did it. So it could not be a reference to the angels. So I'm already refuting you, but you're not listening. But let's not change the subject. You went to too many issues. Let's come back again.
Okay.
Where is your proof that angels are not in the image of God? And let's go back to this issue, because we're going to too many issues.
Okay.
Where does it say angels are not in the image of God?
It doesn't say.
Okay, so now let's go back to your original argument.
Angels
are. I can show you that easily by defining what image means, but I don't want to change the subject. Sister, I know what image means and why angels can be included, but I'm not going to change the subject. I want to come back to your argument, because your argument is Jesus is the image of God, and that's why he's the physical embodiment of God. I said, no, that doesn't work, because man is the image of God. Now, I don't know what you believe. Do you believe when a person dies, a human being dies, he's a believer, he's in heaven as a spirit, or do you believe in soul sleep?
Yeah, I don't think he runs around in heaven.
Yeah, you can make him fun. It's not running around. But see, that's why I can't bring up that point. Let's now go back, because we brought too many issues. And notice I'm jumping with you, because when I bring one passage, you jump to another. That's okay. I jump with you. But let's come back again. Let's come back to the issue. Okay. Let's go to Matthew 1:22-23, because you said Emmanuel.
Okay.
Let's go to Matthew 1:22-23.
Okay. Matthew 1.
Because that's what you said, Emmanuel, God with us. Matthew 1:22-23.
Yeah, she will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and his name shall be called Emmanuel, which means God with us.
Now, you added verse 21, which is good. Let's go with 21. Now, it says Jesus is the one who's going to save people from their sins, right?
Yes.
Okay. And the angel says, give him this name because of what he does, right? Call him Jesus because he does this, right?
It doesn't say because he does. It says, behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son.
21. Sister, you're not reading 21. You see, you're not paying attention again. In 21, he says, you shall call his name Jesus, for, and that means this is the reason why you're going to call him Jesus. Read it again. It's right there.
it's Jesus, not Emmanuel, right? Jesus.
Okay, no, he's both Emmanuel because it just said he's Emmanuel. But don't change it. Just take it one at a time. Why is he called Jesus in 121, in verse 21?
Okay, so it says, she will bear a son and you shall call his name Jesus. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
For he will save his people from their sins.
So why is he called Jesus?
Sorry?
Why is he called Jesus?
Because he will save his people from their sins.
And so you answered me. Now we finally got to the point. The reason he's called Jesus is because of what he does. What does the name Jesus have to do with him saving people from their sins? What's the connection with the name?
I'll tell you. So Yeshua, right, literally means Yahweh's salvation.
Beautiful. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Okay, now in the Old Testament, can you show me where God uses a creature to save anyone from their sins? Meaning that he sends a creature to redeem them from their sins.
I mean, it's just animals, not humans.
Okay, so is there any place in the Hebrew Bible where someone other than Yahweh or Jehovah does the actual saving from sins?
From sins, no.
Okay, go to Psalm 130. Psalm 130.
Yeah, not a human. Yeah, Psalm
130, verses 7 to 8. Psalm 130, Psalm verses 7 to
8. 130?
Yeah, verses 7 to 8.
O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plenteous redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities.
So you got it right there. Yahweh, Jehovah, is the one who redeems and he saves Israel, his people, from their sins. Now in Matthew 1, does Jesus actually do the saving from sins? Is he the one who actually does it? Don't guess. Don't tell me, yes, he does. Don't tell me,
Yeah, he does.
Okay.
Because he is the Messiah.
Good, good, good. No, no, it's not because of the Messiah. That's not what it said. It's because he is Yahweh that is salvation. How can Jesus be called Yahweh is our salvation? Let me make the point. How can Jesus be called Yahweh is our salvation and be the one who does the saving? He saves his people from their sins. When you just admit in the Old Testament, no one but Yahweh saves his people from their sins. How can Jesus do that if he's just a man?
Okay, so Jesus is not his father. Yahweh is the ultimate savior of everyone, right?
But who did the saving from sins?
His name is says, right? Yahweh is salvation.
But who is the one?
Salvation is Jesus.
Yeah, so who is the one who did the actual saving from sins? The Father or Jesus?
It's both.
So the Father, you believe, died on the cross and atoned for our sins.
No, he saved Jesus from dying.
No, that's not what I asked you. Who did the actual saving and atoning for sins? Do I even have to prove that to you? You're kidding me, right?
Brother. So listen, hear me out.
Okay.
So Jesus, right, he died for us, right, to free us from our sins.
Oh, he freed us. Okay, so, good.
To free us from our sins, give us a good conscience if we trust in him. So, yeah. So he died for us and God raised him from death.
No,
so
and not only God raised him, he raised himself from death. Don't twist the Bible.
He has authority to lay down his own life and to raise it back up.
And so didn't, and John 2:19 and 22. Hold on, sister. John 2:19-22 said, destroy this temple and I will raise it up in 3 days. So it's not just the Father. Mm-hmm. The Father, Jesus, and the Spirit together raised Jesus' physical body. That brings up another issue, but I'm not going to go there. You keep saying God raised him. Do you believe Jesus was lying when he said, I will raise up my body in 3 days?
One second, brother. You don't believe God raised Jesus from death?
No, you twisted my words. He's just being recorded. Let me repeat it again. The Father, the Son, and the Spirit, all three together raised Jesus' physical body. But do you believe Jesus when he said, I will raise it up, or you think he's lying?
Yes, he will raise it up. He was given the authority to lay it down and raise it up.
But how can he raise himself up on the third day if he wasn't still alive? How did he do that?
Because in Hebrew it says God saved him from death.
Yeah. You can go to Hebrews all you want. Hebrews doesn't contradict John chapter 2. Let's try this again. How could Jesus raise up his body in 3 days if he wasn't alive when his body was in the grave? You didn't answer the question.
So when God saved Jesus by putting his soul back into his body, he rose again, right?
But that's not what Jesus said. I'm going to repeat Jesus one more time. I will raise up the temple you destroy in 3 days. He's doing it just like he raised Lazarus. How did Jesus raise up his physical body on the third day if he wasn't alive when his body was in the grave? You still didn't answer the question.
So you are going to Lazarus. I will go to the little girl, right?
And who raised her? Notice you're changing subject. Who raised the little girl?
Jesus.
Okay, so then you just proved my point. How did Jesus raise up his body on the third day if he wasn't alive when his body in the grave? Now, this is the fourth time I ask you and you didn't answer.
No, you're not letting me finish.
Okay, make your point. Because every example you give me, Jesus did the actual raising. He actually raised Jairus' daughter. He actually raised Lazarus. So he actually raised himself. How are you helping yourself? You're making my case.
No, finish, brother. Let me finish.
All right, good. I'll let you finish.
Okay, so it says that when he said to the girl, rise, right? Little girl, rise. Mm-hmm. So she rose up, right? Mm-hmm. Because he asked him to. And how did he raise her up? Because of the authority given by the Father. Yeah.
And how does that refute that Jesus actually raised her? So you keep tap dancing. God can give him all the authority in the world, and you're still stuck with God gave Jesus the authority that Jesus will personally raise his body. But for him to have authority to personally do that, he still must be alive while his body's in the grave. You still did not answer the question.
No. So if you read Hebrew, that's what I'm getting, but you don't want to use.
No, because Hebrew, sister, if I go to Hebrews, it's going to backfire against you. Hebrews does not contradict John. I know God raised Jesus. Jesus raised Jesus and the Holy Spirit raised Jesus. You're still not listening to me. I know Hebrews 5:7. Hebrews 13:20-21. I know it better than you. God heard him and saved him from death. And God raised Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, back to life. Hebrews 5:7, Hebrews 13:20-21. That still doesn't contradict that when God raised him, God and Jesus and the Spirit together work together to raise Jesus' body. So you'd never answered my question. I'm going to ask you the fifth time, sister. How did Jesus raise up his body if he wasn't alive?
His soul was, his spirit was with the Father, right?
So he was alive?
Not in the flesh.
No, forget the flesh. Was he still alive?
Yes, his spirit was alive.
So now you believe Jesus, who's alive, can work with the Father and the Spirit to do things that God does, such as raise the dead and raise himself, right?
He was not like literally alive. It means that he's given the spirit to his God in his hand.
Right? And where was the spirit? Was he alive? Was he conscious?
It doesn't specify in the Bible that he was alive.
Yes,
dead,
it does.
Right, the spirit.
No, yes, it does. John 2:19-20 says, I will raise it up. The only way he can raise it up if he was still alive and conscious, even though he was not in the body. Yes, it does. It's John 2:19-22. Destroy this temple. I myself will raise it up in 3 days. And then the Jews said it took 46 years to build this temple and you will raise it up.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, it does tell us he was alive and conscious. But since you want to go to Hebrews, let's go to Hebrews. Can we go to Hebrews now? Because I told you, you don't want to go to Hebrews.
It's the first question, brother.
Okay.
You're all roaming around. I mean, we're going for
because I'm jumping with you. You keep going places.
Yeah.
So the first question was, did Jesus save people from their sins? Yes. So if he saved people from their sins, then that makes sense why he's called Yahweh is salvation. Because he is the Yahweh that does the salvation because he actually saves from sins. You're the one jumping, and I'm trying to keep up with you.
No, I'm just saying that Jesus is God's salvation to humanity. That's what
Jesus
I say.
Is the God who saves humanity. That's what Matthew 1:21 is saying.
I don't think so.
Yes, it did. It's right there. Call his name Jesus, because he, Jesus, will save his people from their sins. What do you mean you don't think so? It's right there.
Because when the preacher, I think it's Samuel or someone, let me just check that. When he saw Jesus when he was born, right? He says, my eyes have waited so long to see God's salvation.
Sure, because there it's the Father, right?
Can you give me the reference?
Yeah, it's like Luke chapter 2. You can read from 25 to 35. Luke 2, 25 to 35.
Yep. So it says, now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, looking for the consolation of Israel, and Holy Spirit was upon him, and it has been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he should not see death before he had seen Lord's Christ. Mm-hmm. And inspired by the Spirit, he came into the temple. Parents, okay, where's that?
It's right there. Keep reading. When he puts gets baby in his arms. He goes, now let your servant depart in peace, because my eyes have seen your salvation.
Salvation, right? Yahweh's salvation is Jesus. Basically, only salvation. Yahweh's salvation is Jesus. Okay. He's not Yahweh.
No, he Yahweh's is. Salvation. Because again, you keep assuming. See, this is the problem with you. You keep assuming that if the Father is Yahweh, Jesus can't be Yahweh. No.
He can't. He can. Because Jesus comes in the name of his Father.
Okay.
So definitely, so, that's his name.
Okay, in 1 Samuel 17:45, David comes in the name of Jehovah of hosts. So I can call David Jehovah?
He's a representative of Yahweh, yes.
Okay, so why don't you call David Jehovah, my Lord and my God? Can you show me where he's called Jehovah, David? Where David's called Jehovah?
Three times.
Wait, Jesus was called, can you Lord. Show? No, you're not listening to me. So you don't listen to your argument and you're not listening. Let me try this again. You said Jesus came in the name of his Father, so he can be called Yahweh. It's John 5:43. David came in the name of Jehovah, the God of armies, the Jehovah, the God of hosts. He goes, I come to you in the name of Jehovah, the God of armies, 1 Samuel 17:45. If I use the way you're interpreting the Bible, that means I can call David Jehovah, the God of armies. Now, can you show me where David is called Jehovah, the God of armies?
You quoted, right? One second. He's called Lord, but right.
No, I didn't say that. He comes in the name of Jehovah, the God of armies. And you said, because Jesus comes in the name of the Father, he can be called Yahweh, Jehovah. So now be consistent.
He's a representative of Yahweh, brother. Right?
Say what?
His name itself says Yahweh is salvation.
Okay.
He's called Yahweh salvation.
But sister, you don't understand what I'm saying, right? You just refuted yourself, right? Coming in the name of the Father doesn't mean you call him Jehovah, because David comes in the name of Jehovah and he's still not called Jehovah. So that means there has to be another reason why Jesus is called Jehovah is salvation, not the reason you gave.
He is called, his name is called Yahweh is salvation.
Why?
Right? Because God will save his people from their sins.
No, it says he, the child, will save his people from their sins. And he is God in the flesh, I agree. But it says he, the child, will save people from his sins. The child is doing it.
Mm-hmm.
So why is he called Jehovah's salvation? Not because he comes in his Father's name. That argument put aside. That's not going to work.
Okay.
So why is he called Jehovah's salvation if he's not Jehovah in the flesh? Jehovah himself, not simply the Father dwelling in him.
It doesn't say Jehovah in flesh, brother. Nowhere I've read in the Bible.
So when the child who's born, sister, the child who's born, is he in the flesh? Because it's Matthew 1, it's about the virgin birth. So when the baby was born, he was in flesh. What was he then?
I'm asking you, brother.
Yeah, right there, Matthew
Jesus,
1.
God manifested in flesh.
Okay,
that
sister.
Is Yahweh manifested in Jesus.
Okay, let's try this again because we're tap dancing. Yeah. Let's try this again. Matthew 1:21-23 talks about the virgin who's now pregnant with child by the Holy Spirit. That child, Joseph will name him when he's born, Jesus. That's Matthew 1:21. So when the child is born, he's not flesh, or is he flesh when the child is born?
He's flesh.
Okay, now first step, let's take it step by step. So he's flesh, and that child who's in the flesh is called Jehovah is salvation, and that child is the one who will actually save his people from their sins. So yes, that's Jehovah in the flesh. I just gave it to you.
No,
yeah, let's laugh.
There's no word saying that he's Jehovah.
Yes, because his name is Jesus. Why is his name Jesus?
Brother, you know that Isaiah, right, Joshua, all are called Yahweh's salvation.
Okay, sister, can you tell me, where in the Old Testament says, call him Isaiah because Isaiah will save his people from their sins? Why are you playing these games with me?
I'm just saying, brother, it's just a name.
No, right? It's not just
a
name. Sister, it's not just a name. Okay, sister, let's try this again. This is now six times we're wasting time. We're going to go somewhere else. In Matthew 1:21, in Matthew 1:21, we are told why he's called Jesus. Call him Jesus for this reason. He is called Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. Now, I want you to quote to me an Old Testament passage where it says Isaiah is called Isaiah because Isaiah himself will save Israel from their sins.
Isaiah didn't save anyone.
Oh, but does Jesus save anyone? Does Jesus save anyone?
Right?
So wait.
He's the Christ. He's the anointed.
So Jesus will actually save. Jesus will actually save. He will actually save people from their sins, right?
Yes.
Oh, that's why he's called Jesus. But Isaiah is not called Isaiah because Isaiah saves anyone. So can you stop these arguments? You mentioned Isaiah and Jeremiah. Can you stop these arguments? They're bad arguments. Can you stop?
Yeah, sure. But you have to stop saying that Yahweh is in flesh.
Yes, I don't stop because that's what Matthew says. The child is flesh and the child is Jehovah who saves.
Okay. Finish your argument.
Okay, now Matthew 1:22-23 says the virgin conceives and gives birth to a son and he's called Emmanuel, which means God is with us. Is Jesus the God who's with us or no?
He's not God with us. He's in him dwelt the fullness of God. So God dwelt in a man and he made his dwelling among us.
My goodness, you even misquote Colossians 2 verse 9. Stuff for all. Anyway, you don't want to go to Colossians 2 9. Let's stick with this. Let me prove to you Jesus is God who is with us. Can you read Matthew 28:20?
Matthew 28:20. Okay.
Read it
from. So it says, teaching them to observe all things I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always to the close of the age.
Who's speaking?
Jesus.
So is Jesus himself going to be with all the disciples to the end of the age? He himself?
Just through the Spirit.
Okay, now you keep adding words. Does Jesus himself, is he himself going to be with all the disciples to the close of the age?
Not literally.
Okay.
Spirit, right?
Okay, I'm going to ask it again, sister. I don't know why it's hard for you to read the Bible. May God have mercy on you. Is Jesus himself, he just said, I will be with you. I will be with you till the closing age. He said it. Why are you not?
Yes.
So will he be with
them? I'm not denying that he's not going to be there. Okay, I'm just saying how he's going
to
be there.
No, we'll get to the how in a minute. So it's him, right? He's the one who's going to be with them?
Yes.
So then, sister, explain to me, why then are you going to deny that he is actually the God who is with us? When Jesus ends the gospel by saying, I am with you, it's not simply the Father who's with them. He himself is with us. So that means he himself is the God who dwells with us.
So this was told by Jesus after his resurrection, when he became a life-giving spirit, right?
Oh, so Jesus is not in the flesh?
This is after his resurrection.
And was he still in the flesh after his resurrection? He still has a body of flesh or no? You're confusing me now.
Flesh and bones. Yeah, he has flesh and bones. Okay,
so when Jesus was on earth, did he give life or no?
Yes, he did. He gave life because he has the authority to give life.
Okay, so why are you going to 1 Corinthians 15:45 that Jesus says Jesus is a life-giving spirit when he was already giving life on earth before the resurrection? Why do you keep going every place in the Bible and can't stick to one point? See, when I jump with you... Okay, when I jump with you, then we go here. And he said, oh, brother, but let's come back to the point. Let's stick to the point. Let's stick with Matthew. Stick with Matthew. Matthew ends the gospel. Matthew ends the gospel by saying, mm-hmm. I will be with all of you to the close of the age. So in Matthew 1, when the child is born, the child is God who's with us. And then Jesus ends the gospel by saying, I am with you. It's the same language. So then why do you deny Jesus himself is the God who comes to dwell with us?
Because of context.
And I just gave you the context.
The context here in 20 is talking about the resurrected Jesus.
Okay. Was he with them before the resurrection?
Matthew chapter 1 is talking about his when he was born as a child.
Was he with them before the resurrection?
As a physical human being, yes.
And, but you just said even after the resurrection, he was the, in physical, right? Physical and bodily, right? So you keep adding words to the text. Let's make it simple.
The physical body and the resurrected body.
And the resurrected body is a physical body, right?
Yes, it is.
Okay,
it's,
so
it's
sister, can you help me?
It's not the old body.
Okay,
it's
sister,
a new body.
Can you help me? Stop adding words because it's you're adding words and I'm having to correct you. Let's make it simple. Let's keep it simple. Was Jesus already with them before the resurrection? Don't give me physical not. Just was he with them?
Okay, yes, he was with them.
And so you just made my point. Jesus is the God who was with them on earth, and now he's still the God who will remain with them till the end of the age, even though physically he's in heaven. And you haven't refuted anything.
We keep skipping and you automatically assume that Jesus is literally God.
No, I gave you proof he's literally God because he literally does what only God does. Save people from their sins. He's omnipresent, so on and so forth.
Hello?
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Okay, now, let me give you a final passage. And, go ahead.
Second, I'm not able to hear you.
All right, hold on. Right.
Can you hear me now?
Can you hear me? I can hear you.
Yep, I can hear you now.
Okay, sister, let's try a final passage and then we'll continue some other time because we spent over 80 minutes and we keep arguing about passages and we got nowhere. And okay, I want you to explain to me because I know how you Unitarians explain it.
Mm-hmm.
John 20:28, when Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. Why? Why did he say my Lord and my God?
Because he truly believed what Jesus said. He doubted that I and the Father are one, right? He didn't believe that. And after his resurrection, he finally understood what it means.
Okay, what does it mean? Because I don't think you understand what it means. So what it means?
It says that the context of that is the resurrection again, right?
Yes.
Let's not forget the context. So when he is resurrected, Thomas finally understood that he is the Messiah and that he was sent by God.
But that didn't explain why is he calling him my Lord and my God.
He's not calling him my Lord and my God.
Yes, he is.
It can be interpreted in two ways because that would make Jesus a liar.
It cannot be.
Because in the same passage, Jesus said to Mary, do not cling on to me.
Yeah.
I go to my Father, your Father, my God, your God.
Okay, sister.
So you're literally making Jesus a second God here.
No, sister, stop twisting the verses. I know John 20:17. You're twisting, but I'm not going to let you get away with it. Yes, we know what it means because it says, Thomas answered and said unto him, Ipen auto, meaning to him, my Lord and my God. Mm-hmm. because you're a Unitarian heretic, you think that if the Father is Jesus' God and the disciples' God, then Jesus can't be their God. No, that's why we're Trinitarian, because of these passages. The Father can be their God and Jesus be their God, because the Father and Son with the Spirit are the one God. So I'm going to ask you the question again. Why did Thomas call Jesus, call him my Lord and my God? You didn't answer it. You tap dance, but you didn't answer it.
It's not tap dancing. Okay, it's just a different way of interpreting the same passage. It can either mean referring to two, or it could be an expression.
There is
when you see someone dead he comes back to life, he just said, my God and my Lord.
Sister,
he's addressing both.
Sister, you know, in Exodus 20, verse 7, Exodus 20, verse 7, it says, you are not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. If that's what he's doing, oh, my God and my Lord, then Jesus would have rebuked him, because that's violating Exodus 20, verse 7. It's a shame that you would have Thomas sinning and taking God's name in vain, and yet Jesus does not correct him. So no, there's only one interpretation. So I'm going to ask you a third time. Why did Thomas call Jesus my Lord and my God?
That's your assumption.
No, it's the Bible. It's not assumption.
Okay, one second. When David was fleeing from his son, he always addressed, my God, my Lord, right?
In prayer. He's crying out to God in prayer, not just saying it flippantly like you did. That backfired against you. So why did Thomas call him my Lord and my God? I'm still waiting for the answer.
I already told you the answer, but okay, you didn't like it.
All right, listen, how about this? We'll talk more maybe in the upcoming week, because it's only over 80 minutes. Thank you so much. I'll contact you this week. We'll set up another discussion about the Trinity, all right?
I hope I can answer the question, the initial question sometime.
Yeah, this week. We will hopefully hopefully you'll learn next time to stick with one passage and we don't fly 50,000 places and get nowhere. Okay, so get ready. Sometime this week, I'll contact you, God willing, all right?
Okay, God willing.
Take care.
Have a great day.
God be with you and guide you to the truth, my sister in humanity. Take care.
Bye.
Okay, folks, that's what you get. This is Unitarianism. This is Anthony Buzzard's teaching, poisoning people in India. So let me tell you guys what you just listened. You have this sister in humanity who's in India, who has been poisoned by the filth, the blasphemy, the satanic lies of Unitarians like Anthony Buzzard. You see, their lie, their poison has reached even India, the Indian continent. You see that? Yep, exactly, Andrew. So what does that tell you, folks? What does that tell you? Early morning, we had a good crowd. All glory to the triune God. What does that tell you, folks? This is what it tells you. That we need to be praying. We need to be seeking the face of God. We need to ask the Holy Spirit to fill us. We need to ask the Holy Spirit to make us pure and holy and in love with Jesus. And we need the Holy Spirit to make us spiritual warriors, lions and lionesses, to know our faith, to understand the Bible, because we are the salt of the earth and the light of the world. We are the hands and feet of Jesus. And the Lord's going to work through us to destroy these lies, these blasphemies, and to take captive every thought and make it obedient to the true Jesus, who's God in the flesh. So you saw it. She's in India. She's in India, right? And in India, she's already been poisoned by the filth and blasphemy of Unitarianism. That's where we come in. So pray for one another. Pray for the apologists like myself. Pray the Holy Spirit fills us. Pray the Holy Spirit makes us holy and in love with Jesus and obedient to Jesus, and to know the word and live it and proclaim it. Pray the Lord will protect us from Satan and satanic distractions. Pray for further provision. And in my case, pray for my angels this morning. Ask Jesus to bless them and love them and save them from any man. Bring them to me. Lord willing, I'm going to be on today with David Wood, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I'm going to be on with David Wood on his YouTube channel, Acts 17 Apologetics, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And the topic is answering Jehovah's Witnesses. Answering Jehovah's Witnesses. So Lord willing, look for that show, 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. answering Jehovah's Witnesses. It's the Lord's Day. It's Sunday. It's the Resurrection Day. Our Lord is risen. Christ is risen. He has destroyed Satan, sin, and death, and the grave. Christ is risen. He's alive, can never die. May the Lord Jesus increase in us. May the Lord Jesus wash us and our loved ones, my daughters, in his precious blood. May the Lord Jesus flood us, our loved ones, my daughters, in his love. May the Lord Jesus seal us by his spirit to be in love with him. We love you, Lord Jesus. And with Thomas, we say, Lord Jesus, you are our Lord, our God. You are my Lord and my God and our Savior, my Savior. We love you, Son of God. Be glorified in our lives. In Jesus' name, Maranatha. Pray for me, guys. Pray for my daughters. I need your prayers. I haven't seen them in a year. I'm aching for them, and they need their Bob in their life. Please ask Jesus, say, Lord, remove that man, Martin. Keep that demon away from them. Break him and their mother. Save his daughters. Bring them to me, Lord Jesus. Please ask the Lord to remove that man, Martin, and to chasten their mother, Michelle, to repent of her immorality so I can have my daughters. I miss my daughters. If you believe the Lord has called me to ministry, covenant with me, pray for my protection, pray for my daughters, pray the Lord will bring them to me. I ache for them. It's been a year, guys. I have not seen my children, and I miss them. But they're in good hands if they're in the hands of Jesus. I love you guys. See you tonight. We had a good crowd for early morning. It was 6:30 my time, 6:30 a.m. in my morning my time, but we still had close to 300 people. People are hungry for the word. Amen. May we always thirst and always hunger for Jesus, always and forever. We love you, Lord Jesus. Take care. See you tonight. David Woodstream. Christ is risen indeed.